Rally Club of Chicago is very proud to be the only private club in the United States with an institutional commitment to public policy advocacy and community service. The reason that the club has been engaged in this endeavor for the last 140 plus years is connected to our founding in 1879, just a few years prior to the Civic Federation. This club is a descendant of a movement that arose during the Civil War that referred to itself as the Union Leagues of America, a citizen volunteer organization dedicated to helping President Lincoln defend the Union. That's where the Union in our Union League Club of Chicago name comes from. And because of that legacy, we have been engaged for well over 100 years in civic programming such as this and gathering the community to talk about the issues that concern us all. And today's program is squarely in that tradition. So the club is proud of its traditions, but we are equally proud to be partnering with our friends at the Civic Federation, an organization that, like the Union League Club, is dedicated to informing the community. And I hope everyone has had an opportunity to pick up this, some of the materials, the outstanding materials that are available at the registration desk. And I'm struck by the description of the Civic Federation's mission, and it describes itself as a valuable civic infrastructure and the only independent nonpartisan resource for evaluating and analyzing the extraordinary financial, governance, and other challenges faced by the state of Illinois and some of its largest governments, including the city of Chicago and Chicago Public Schools. That is entirely accurate. My only quibble with this language is that the Civic Federation, it's not a valuable civic infrastructure, it is an invaluable civic infrastructure. And I would like to thank my friend and colleague Lawrence Massal, the president of the Civic Federation, for continuing to work with this club and our public affairs committee to put on important programs such as this. And now I am pleased to yield the lectern and the floor to Carol Thompson, who is going to take us forward. Carol?
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you all for joining us for today's candidate panel. I'm Carol Thompson. I'm a partner at Chapman & Cutler. And along with Donovan Pepper, I'm the co-chair of the Civic Federation's Criminal Justice Committee. Before we begin, I'd like to extend the Civic Federation's thanks to a number of people and organizations. First to Dave Cohn and the Union League Club of Chicago for partnering with us on this event and for hosting us this morning. I'd also like to thank the Elizabeth Morse Charitable Trust for their generous support of our criminal justice research and their sponsorship of this event. I'd like to thank Annie McGowan, the Civic Federation's liaison to the Criminal Justice Committee and all her work on this event. And a special thanks to our panelists for joining us bright and early this morning. You're all apparently morning people, one of whom will take office in the coming months. So very glad to have you here. The Circuit Court of Cook County is the largest judicial circuit in Illinois and the second largest unified court system in the world. The clerk of the circuit court is responsible for maintaining all court files, recording court proceedings and determinations, and collecting fines and fees of the court. The office remains fairly obscure and opaque, especially for those unfamiliar with the court system, and it has long been plagued with reports of inefficiency, disorganization, and patronage. In November, Cook County voters will elect a new circuit court clerk for the first time since the year 2000. Therefore, the Civic Federation and the Union League Club of Chicago organize this forum as an opportunity to hear from our candidates and how they would modernize the office and improve efficiency and transparency. Thank you again for everyone for joining us today. I'll now turn it over to Donovan Pepper to make introductions.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Carol. I appreciate that. And thank you all again for being here this morning, this early morning. And I have not had my cup of coffee yet, so if I stumble, I apologize. But as Carol mentioned, I am Donovan Pepper. I work for the Walgreen Corporation. But it's my pleasure to be here in the capacity as co-chair of this, our Criminal Justice Committee, which is our newly formed Criminal Justice Committee here at the Civic Federation. With that said, it's my pleasure to introduce our guests with us today, candidates for this office, and I have to say, three of the four candidates are longtime friends of mine, so it's a unique pleasure that I have to introduce all four of the candidates, but particularly, I've known the staff member for Jacob Meister for a very long time, and Richard, who's in the audience here, is also a very good friend. So it's nice to be here to welcome our friends here. First, I would like to introduce our moderator for today's panel. As you heard from Carol mentioned, Lawrence Massall, who is our president of the Civic Federation. He's been our president here since 2002. He has a very long and distinguished career in public service, including serving in the administrations of two former governors, Illinois governors, and not the one that just came back from Colorado, I should add. He is a graduate of Knox College and Loyola University Law School. So Lawrence will be our moderator today. Richard Boykin is a former Cook County Commissioner who happens to be my former Cook County Commissioner and is a longtime friend and has previously served as Chief of Staff to U.S. Congressman Danny Davis, also my Congressman Danny Davis. He's Commissioner Boykin is currently a partner at the law firm of Barnes and Thornburg. Mike Cabanargi, who currently serves as a commissioner on the Cook County Board of Review, the commissioner has previously served as a senior attorney with the Securities and Exchange Commission and as a judicial clerk in the Northern District of Illinois. And as a sidebar, Michael has two boys the same age as my boys, and they're probably, I think yours are a little taller now than my my oldest, but him and his wife have been longtime friends as well. State Senator Iris Martinez, who is with us, who also is an amazing woman and longtime friend. She has served in the Illinois Senate since 2002, when she was elected as the first Hispanic woman elected to the Illinois Senate. The senator is the former vice chair of the Illinois Democratic Party, and she currently serves as the chair of the Democratic National Committee's Hispanic Caucus. Welcome here. And Jacob Meister. Mr. Meister serves as an attorney at the firm of Jacob Meister and Associates, and has previously served as a staff member in the U.S. House of Representatives and in the Wisconsin State Senate. He is the founder and chair of the Civil Rights Agenda, which is dedicated to advancing and protecting the rights of LGBT Illinoisans. Thank you very much for being
here.
Thank you. Additional biographical information can be found in your programs that you have at your desk. But again, thank you all for being here this morning. And now I'll turn the podium over to Lawrence Massall.
Thank you, Donovan, and thank you to Carol and to Dave for co-hosting this with us. It's my honor and pleasure to moderate today's discussion. The format will be as follows. Each panelist, in alphabetical order by last name, will have 2 minutes to make an opening statement. Our timekeeper will hold up cards indicating when 30 seconds is remaining and when your allotted time has ended. Following opening statements, I'll ask a series of questions. Each panelist will have 2 minutes to respond to each question. Any candidate name checked during the responses will be allowed 30 seconds for a rebuttal. Again, our timekeeper will hold up the signal cards. Following that portion of the Q&A, we will take questions from the audience. Responses, again, will be limited to 2 minutes in an effort to make sure that everyone is heard, all of our panelists and candidates, with, again, a 30-second rebuttal option for name-checked candidates. Audience members, if you have questions, please fill out the cards on your table, and a staff member will come by to pick them up. Just hold up your card if you're not getting that attention. If you are inclined, please indicate your name and organization or just your question. Now we'll begin with opening statements. Each candidate will have 2 minutes to describe what reforms they would like to bring to the Circuit Court Clerk's office. And we ask, what do they see as their highest priority issue and in need of change. We'll start alphabetically with Commissioner Boykin.
You've already started my time. No, man, go back to zero. Go back to zero. Come on now, let's be fair. I'm Richard Boykin, and I'm proud to be here. I want to thank the Civic Federation. I want to thank the Union League Club. I was born in Mississippi and raised in Englewood. I'm a proud graduate of Chicago Vocational High School. And I went to Central State University undergrad at the University of Dayton School of Law. I've been a lawyer for over 20 years. Worked in 13 years for three members of Congress. And I'm proud to run for the clerk's office. The clerk's office is the front door to our justice system. That front door ought to be wide open, welcoming, and free of political influence. I'm running because I think that the clerk's office ought to remain answerable only to the people and not to the political Cook County Democratic machine. I actually have a track record of actually following my conscience and putting people ahead of politics. I took on the NRA, and we got past an assault weapons ban in Cook County. We won that fight. I stood up for women, and I took the tax off of feminine hygiene products. We won that fight. Now I want to stand up for you as your clerk of the Circuit Court of Cook County. There are a number of things that we need to do. We need to move the office forward, move it into the 21st century. I plan to do that by making sure that the e-record is the official record of the court, electronic record. And we want to move that court system to a paperless court system. I also plan to have remote access to documents for everyone, not just the parties to the case and those attorneys. I want to make sure that we motivate our staff. Currently, we have a staff that is not necessarily motivated. We want to motivate them and make sure that they're excited about the work that they're doing and excited about being public servants. We want to improve the customer service at the clerk's office. There are a number of things else that we'd like to do. I see that my time is almost concluded, and so I encourage you to read the Boykin Plan at richardrboykin.com. But I'm excited about this opportunity. And again, I'm proud to be here today. Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Carbonaggi.
Thank you to the Civic Federation and to the Union League Club again for hosting today's important discussion. For those of us in down ballot races like this, thank you for giving us your time and attention. It's a pleasure to see Lawrence Massal again. We served together on Governor Pritzker's Transition Committee on the Budget Committee, and it's a pleasure again to speak to the Civic Federation. I've spoken to you all a number of times to your subcommittee on property taxation. I'm running for the clerk of the court's office because I want to bring technology, transparency, and talent to the office while helping making Cook County a more open and just home. Let's take an office stuck in yesterday, bring it into today, and most importantly, prepared for tomorrow. I spent my entire career in public service. I was an aide to Senator Paul Simon, an aide to Senator Dick Durbin, clerked for a federal judge here in town, and then was an award-winning federal prosecutor at the SEC, where I investigated and prosecuted fraud and corruption, including Ponzi schemes, pay-to-play schemes throughout the Midwest and the country. Now, as chair of the Cook County Board of Review, I lead the country's largest property tax appeals office, and I help homeowners pay only their fair share in property taxes and not a penny more. When the judge appointed me to the bench, to the Board of Review, it looked just like their clerk's office did, a paper-based system that only spoke English. We translated the office forms into English, Spanish, Polish, Mandarin, and we were the whole operation online. We did it on time and on budget, and now 93% of the appeals of the Board of Review come in online. Compare that to the clerk of the court's office that spent $24 million a few years ago to build a new warehouse in Cicero. It's not just technology, it's also transparency and talent. On my first day, I'll appoint a FOIA officer who will look for ways to produce documents to the public and not look for excuses to hold them back. FOIA makes me a better commissioner and a better chair of the Board of Review. It makes me more accountable to the public, and it makes my office more responsible. But it's also about access to justice in Cook County. I will work to end cash bail. I applaud Governor Pritzker's efforts. I'm working with the Bail Project right now. On top of that, I want to change the law. And on my first day as your clerk of the courts, we'll eliminate the process in the office right now where you take the maximum amount. So again, look forward to answering your questions and speaking with you all today. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Carbonaggi. Senator Martinez.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I too want to thank the Union League and the Civic Federation for hosting this event. I think for the first time in over 20 years, we're finally going to have an opportunity to probably actually bring some sunshine and transparency into an office that has been so overshadowed by so much corruption, patronage, and bad management. But I want to say that my intentions are, the first day when I get there is to call for an audit of the complete system, the whole Cook County Clerk's Office. I think it's important that we get to see where the real problems are. As a lawmaker for 18 years, we've dealt with a lot of things down in Springfield, budget issues, and I think right now, if we're going to really look at the rooted problem that exists in the clerk's office, we have to start with an audit. We have to look at the performance and the operational expenditures that are going out there. We have to look at the workforce and ask the workforce, when was the last time were they trained? And when you talk about having courtrooms that are empty right now because there's no clerks, that to me is unacceptable. There are too many people that are out there pending, waiting for their day in court, and this to me is one of my priorities, making sure that we can look at the problem that's going on at the clerk's office right now and see how we can transform it and actually open it up to the public, open it up to make it very transparent so we can actually see where the problems are rooted at. I plan to introduce, and as a matter of fact, I already filed my bill on FOIA. I think it's important that the Cook County's clerk's office should be FOIA-able. That's the only way we're going to be able to really dig deep and find where the problems are at and start addressing them. Yes, the modernization of technology is something very key. We've had a couple of rollouts that have not worked, and why is that happening? Why do we pay the kind of money we pay to a system like Tyler, and we still have a system that no one can actually understand? I plan to bring in, I think it's important if we're going to address the technology issue, we have to make sure we bring in all the other entities that fit into the clerk's office. And that is a few of my plans for the office.
Thank you, Senator Martinez. Mr. Meister.
Thank you. I want to thank the Civic Federation for holding this forum. It's great to see so many engaged individuals who care about this office. It's an office that's very near and dear to my heart. Unlike my opponents, I'm the candidate in this race who has practiced regularly for the last 29 years in the circuit court. It is a massive court system, very complex with lots of divisions. I'm proud to say I've practiced in every division but one, and that gives me the ability to understand what this office needs, how to reform it, and as I say, this is an office that is broken operationally and ethically. The clerk's office is a machine-controlled patronage den of disappearing files and dinosaur age technology that needs to be fixed operationally and ethically. I've spent my career in the court system and other court systems around the country. I know how a good system works and how ours needs to be fixed. That's what makes me well-suited for this job. I know that many people working in the clerk's office, our judges and lawyers, are frustrated and want the office to be cleaned up, and certainly career politicians will not make that happen. It requires someone with intimate knowledge of how the courts function. The clerk's job is to make sure that the system is accessible, navigable, efficient for stakeholders with minimal bureaucratic or political interference. You have my plan in front of you. It's a plan for modernization, customer service, transparency, and access for justice. Ethically, the office needs to be reformed. Politics needs to be removed from the office. This is a ministerial office that should function efficiently for everyone and all stakeholders. I'm the reformer in this race. This is our first opportunity in 20 years to remove the office from the political control of pay-to-play politics and insider politics. Recently, our voters have made clear with the election of Fritz Kagi and Lori Lightfoot that they won't have it anymore. I hope you'll join me in reforming this office.
Thank you, Mr. Meister. So we'll get to some of our questions from the Civic Federation, and each of you will have the opportunity to respond to these. The relationship between the Circuit Court Clerk and the Cook County Chief Judge is at best complicated and often hard to understand where the line is drawn between the two offices. Currently, any FOIA request or data request to the county clerk has to go through the chief judge's office for approval. How do you plan to approach your relationship with the chief judge as you administer your independently elected office? We'll start again. Why don't we start with Mr. Meister in reverse order now?
Yeah, I've practiced, I think this is the advantage of my practice. I've worked with so many of the judges in the court system. I know Chief Judge Evans. I think what we've had over the last 20 years is a fundamental lack of trust between the clerk's office and the chief judge's office. That needs to be fixed. What we've seen is the chief judge taking back control of many different areas that the clerk traditionally and historically has had control of. You have to remember that the clerk's primary function is to serve the judges. And when we have political infighting between the clerk's office and the judiciary, our system breaks down, and that's where we found it. So I think the chief judge, fortunately, has just come out with a new general order, which opens up access to a lot of data. That is going to be important for our academicians, our practitioners, everybody who needs access to court information. And let's keep in mind that the court system is a hub of information that is relied upon by all the stakeholders. And when I say that, the Illinois Department of Corrections relies on accurate and timely information from the court system, our sheriff's department, our state's attorney, our public defenders, our private lawyers, our journalists, so that our academicians need data and information, and it's locked up right now in a paper-based system. We need to change that. We need to be mindful of all stakeholders and provide transparency so that the system works. And ultimately, as you'll see in my plan, I'd like to have an integrated justice information system so that information is shared with everyone who needs to know it.
Senator Martinez, how will you approach your work?
Thank you very much for the question. First and foremost, I introduced Senate Bill 3850 this a few weeks ago. And again, we have to bring sunlight and transparency to the clerk's office. The only way to do that is by a FOIA. Introduce a legislation that right now will make the clerk's office FOIAable, especially some of those areas that we need to look at to see where the deficiencies are at. That's very important. And in the same legislation, also talk about restorative justice and find ways to make sure that the individuals who are being fined, at the end of the day, that money stays back in the county. Why not find ways to give it back to the people who have been harmed by the incarceration and waiting for their court, their day in court? But I think the opportunity to actually work with the Chief Justice Office is going to be very important. I think there's been a gap between all the entities that feed into the clerk's office, the public defender's office, the sheriff's office, the state attorney's office, the public guardian. These are all entities that that feed into the clerk's office somewhere, somehow. We have to find a way to connect them and making sure, especially through the IT. We have a disaster in that office with the IT, the technology. And that's because I think everybody's doing their own thing. And I think it's important that on the first day, bring all the technology folks together. Talk to the Chief Justice, talk to the Sheriff's Office. Find ways that we can actually work as one whole county, not separately. And I think that's been the problem at the county so far in this, and with the last 20 years. But more important, I think we have now the opportunity to actually open this office up and look at the deficiencies, talk to the workers that are there, making sure that they tell us what is going on, how can we make their job better, how do we reinvest in them. We cannot have courtrooms right now empty without clerks. We have to make sure that what's going on in that office is open to the public, and the only way we're going to be able to do that is by FOIA and really get into the heart of what's going on at the clerk's office. I really believe that there is going to be opportunities for us to bring in real experts into this office and really help reform and really bring the transparency that the Cook County really needs right now.
Thank you. Commissioner Carbonari. Carbonari. I've been practicing this for a long time.
One more time, Lawrence. Can you do it?
Carbonari.
We're not all blessed with Masal. Yeah. Some of us
I apologize, Kevin R.G.
Please, you should see my junk mail, Lawrence. It's awesome. Your question goes toward, I think, two things. Relationships at the county and getting things done in a complicated structure where you don't control your own budget. Although you have almost 1,400 employees, most of your funds comes from the county in addition to four special purpose funds. But then also FOIA. I've already addressed that in my introduction. On day one, I will have a FOIA officer. The circuit court has been plagued with scandals, investigations, indictments, and convictions for too many years. Public trust and confidence in its court system is critical to its functioning society. However, under the current law, the judiciary is not subject to the Freedom of Information Act as our other government agencies, including the Board of Review, and groups including the Civic Federation have reported difficulty in obtaining Cook County records. Without access to data, the public and the stakeholders in the justice system lack the tools to determine how effectively, efficiently, and fairly the court programs are working, and the public trust further fades away. I will appoint a FOIA officer who looks to comply with FOIA, who looks for opportunities to open up the office and share data. I'm gonna give you an example. The Board of Review, we participate in the county's open data project. The Circuit Court Clerk's Office should participate in the open data project. What is the open data project? We push our data into a central server where sociologists and criminologists can take a look at it. So let's digitize the paper records and the microfiche, get them online in a searchable form. So we can have sociologists and criminologists look at it and look at things like, what's the average age of someone who seeks a protective order? What's their race? What's their gender? What's their education level? There are a lot of opportunities we can move the office forward. This is an opportunity, if we've all talked about it, for the first time in 20 years, we will have a new clerk. And you have to ask yourself, who is ready on day one to do the job? Who's already led a Cook County office with Cook County staff and taken county resources to take a paper-based office and made it digital and motivated and led the team to do it? I'm the only one up here who's done that. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Kevin Argy. Commissioner Boykin.
The question really is the relationship between the chief judge, but I think you need to expand it even further because the Illinois Supreme Court actually sets the rules for the circuit court and for the chief judge. And so you have that relationship that you have to deal with as well. And I'm proud to say that, you know, people talk about a lot of things. They're the only one that does this and does that. I'm the only one up here who's voted on the budgets of each one of these offices. That's the sheriff, the state's attorney, the public defender, public guardian, the chief judge, all of them. I have a tremendous relationship with the chief judge, and I believe that that relationship will inure to the benefit of all of the taxpayers of Cook County. I also will say this and correct the record. The clerks don't just respond to the judges. The clerks' responsibility as public servants are to serve all of the citizens of Cook County, the attorneys who are seeking access to the office, the pro se litigants, those individuals who are representing themselves, and everyone who comes through those doors. And so I also want to expand this relationship with the chief judge. I just unveiled the automatic expungement plan. Automatic expungement is currently taking place for certain levels of cannabis. Well, what I've discovered is that over 379,000 people were arrested in Cook County last year. Of that number, 245,000 were African Americans arrested, only to have charges dropped in about 48,000 cases. If you have an arrest and have those charges dropped, under my plan, we will actually expunge your record as the clerk without having you to hire an attorney or without having you to do it yourself. Why is that important? Because these arrests are holding too many people back from getting jobs, public housing, and educational opportunities. I think the clerk's role is more than just keeping records. It's also about social equity and social justice. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Let's dig a little deeper into this idea of FOIA and what is, should be the role of FOIA. The Illinois courts have interpreted for themselves that they're not covered by FOIA. That's a pretty broad reading of the statute and a little bit different than we see in many of our other states and jurisdictions. We'll start with Mr. Meister. What is your view on whether the clerk's office and thus the courts should be subject to FOIA?
Well,
I think one thing we have to be mindful of is the private and sensitive information that's contained in a lot of the court files about individuals that does need to be protected. You know, whether it's individuals' account numbers, there's a lot of information in court files that's sensitive that we need to make sure is protected. But beyond that, we have taken way too restrictive of a view of the need to access files. The court files fundamentally are public files and public records and should be as such. I applaud Senator Martinez's effort to expand FOIA from Springfield. I think Springfield has an important part to play in this, as well as the judiciary. I absolutely have a plan for transparency, FOIA. We should be absolutely responsive to FOIA requests. The media has been denied access, and that is a fundamental part of our democracy in making sure that there's oversight of the court system. Publicly available data should be there for academics who are doing studies. I know there's a lot of criminal justice studies that have been hampered as a result of not having criminal records available, the data from criminal records. That's essential because we as the court system and creating transparency need to make sure that we're helping with crime statistics, family law statistics. There's any number of areas where we need to do better and make our information more accessible, and I applaud the efforts of Senator Martinez in that regard.
Anything you would like to add, Senator Martinez?
Thank you. I'm sorry, I got a little hoarse in my throat today, this morning. But let me just, I think it's important. The only way we're going to be able to look at the public funds that the Cook County Circuit Clerk's Office now uses is the only way we're going to be able to see exactly where the deficiencies are within. And FOIA is a way to open this office up to transparency. It's been pretty obscure all these years. The FOIA will actually help us be able to identify what the use of the public funds are. Are they really being used correctly? Is there ways to be able to take those dollars and fund other parts of the clerk's office that are much more important, important work? I believe that the FOIA is the only way, together with an audit of the performance and the operations of the clerk's office, is the way we're going to be able to look at the situation that really exists right now. There's a crisis within that office because of the lack of management, because of the mismanagement, and the fact that we've been so under the dark cloud, that we've not been able to actually open this up and see where the deficiencies are at. The FOIA is going to do just that. It's going to at least be able to access certain records that are FOIAable. And I think that's the only way we're going to actually bring back the confidence, the public confidence that is needed for that office, because of the fact that we have to, for the first time in 20 years, start fresh, start with very innovative ideas, and the FOIA is one way to get there.
Thank you, Senator. Commissioner Kevin Argy.
Well, thank you. As I said at the outset, I'm subject to FOIA now as the chair of the Board of Review, and it makes me a better public official and a more accountable public servant. And it also makes the office run better, where everybody knows that not only are you accountable in words, but at all points, the public is looking over your shoulder. So act as if somebody's watching you. You have to always act as a public servant in a way where you're being accountable to the public. One other thing I would do, and you all have a copy of my reform plan that's out there, and it focuses on what I said in my introduction, technology, transparency, and talent, all of which serves an access to justice and opening up the people's courthouses. One of the things I say on there is that on day one, I would bring in the Civic Consulting Alliance to do an external forensic investigation. I've worked with CCA at the Board of Review. CCA has helped governors and mayors with their transition plans. We've worked with CCA. If you're not familiar with CCA, it's a fantastic organization here in Chicago where different consultants volunteer their time and efforts to tackle a big civic problem. We need to take a look at day one of the structure of the clerk's office. what's the organization chart? What's the workload balance? What's the number of line clerks to supervisors? What's the dotted line, straight line management responsibilities? What's the load balance between the suburban courthouses and the Daly Center? This is an opportunity for the first time in 20 years to take a fresh look. CCA can be a partner in that as well. That goes to the transparency. The Civic Federation has written a number of reports about this over the years. One of the reports was about the lack of transparency when it comes to fines and fees. Last year, the Illinois Supreme Court wrote a great report about fines and fees. Part of my plan right now is to take a look at all the fees that are being charged. There's four different special purpose fund fees that the clerk's office charges. Do we have an opportunity to sunset these fees when they've served their purpose? When we have a digitization fee, when we digitized all the paper records and the microfiche and we no longer need them in the warehouse, can we get rid of the digitization fee that we charge? We don't know what the end game is because there's no transparency into that office. Again, let's take a look on day one and bring in an external review.
Thank you. Commissioner Boykin.
The question is about FOIA. I'm all for it. I think sunlight is the best disinfectant. When I was a county commissioner, I actually pushed for release of documents as long as people's private information wasn't compromised. But I think, we ought to have the most transparent clerk's office in America. I think that's vitally important. Let me talk for a moment because, a couple of people have talked about fees and fines. And as you all know, about a month and a half ago, I unveiled my plan to actually forgive fees and fines at the clerk's office. The clerk controls the fees. Now, the collection fees and that sort of thing, I think they ought to be forgiven. I think the governor did a great thing a few weeks ago when he signed a bill that said we're no longer going to suspend people's licenses because they can't pay the tickets, fees, and fines on the tickets. But he should have taken it a step further and wiped out that debt altogether because this debt is holding people back. And so I think also, FOIA is important is because you all will really see the magnitude of people who are actually being assessed fees and fines. Many of those folks look like me. They're African Americans. So the court system has basically become a money-making machine on people of color and poor people. That's not right. We will move away from that system once I'm clerk of the circuit court, and on day one, we'll move back in terms of forgiving those debts from the fees, and we'll urge judges to waive those fines, especially those that are 5 years and older. It's a certain level of debt that we're not going to be able to collect. Why even carry it on the books? It makes no sense. And what I'll say about this is that 18 years in the state Senate, and all of a sudden now you're introducing a FOIA bill. Why not have done it 15 years ago, 10 years ago, or whatever? You have to ask yourself that. Thanks.
Senator Martinez, since your name was raised, would you like to respond?
Well, I didn't raise her name. I didn't raise her name.
Oh, you have to stop picking on the commissioner. Stop
Well, I'm sorry, you did not raise her name.
I'm not going to go there with that, but
you don't have to respond.
Let me just say this. Yes, I've been there 18 years, and we've done a lot of great things. Restorative justice has been our number one aspect of what we've been working on. But you know what? When you actually start looking at the when I started to look at this office because of the complaints that came to my office of people, normal people walking to their office and having so many issues getting child support, order of protection, for me it was important. I said, I have to start looking to see what is actually going on. And one of the things that we found, that I found speaking to other attorneys, speaking to people at the sheriff's office, is that we did not have enough information within there. That's why I said, FOIA is the only way. From day one, I've said that we need to do an audit of that office. And at the same time, I decided to edit a FOIA because that's the only way we're going to get a clear picture of what is going on. So, better late than ever. Right, Commissioner?
Thank you. We'll start this question with Commissioner Kevin Argy. Will you, if elected clerk to the clerk's office, will you publish your own data related to the efficiency and the operations of your office, or will it still continue to be at the discretion of the chief judge?
The answer is yes. I will publish data on day one. Before I came to the Board of Review, there was no annual report. when I came Board of Review as a commissioner, I said, we have to do an annual report to the taxpayers. We have to give them the data. It's beyond just FOIA of being responsive. You have to be proactive and put this information out there. The public deserves to know, and they want to know. We put it out in a digestible form. There would be a more useful annual report than is available right now. Listen, some of us read the Civic Federation reports that are issued, and some of us have been reading the Civic Federation reports for years about the clerk's office. The common theme is the lack of transparency. There are fantastic data analysts with the Civic Federation who want to do a deep dive. They can only work with the data they can get their hands in. When I'm clerk of the court, you won't need FOIA to get this data. It'll be voluntarily put online and available to you. We've all talked about the technology and the data. This affects real people. Even if you're not an attorney, the public is interacting with the clerk's office. And I'll give you one example, and that's a man by the name of Gerald Reed. Gerald Reed was arrested when he was 17 years old in 1990, thrown in the back of a car on the west side of the city of Chicago by John Burge, tortured into giving a false confession. Mr. Reed spent almost 30 years in jail. His confession was thrown out 2 years ago. Mr. Reed spent all of 2019 in jail. In December of 2019, Judge Hennessy, who had the case, had to decide, should we retry Mr. Reed or not? And what did Judge Hennessy say? Mr. Reed spent all of 2019 in jail because he couldn't get the trial court record from the circuit court clerk's office. Think about that. We don't know at that point if Mr. Reed is guilty or not guilty, and he has a right to an appeal. State's attorney did their job, the judge wanted to do their job, the appellate defender wanted to do their job, the clerk of the courts failed, and Mr. Reed spent an entire year in jail wondering about his fate. Mr. Reed's not alone. The state appellate defender's office has a list of over 600 people that are in jail right now where it cannot receive the trial court record to move forward. Everybody wants to do their job. When I'm clerk of court on day one, Mr. Reed and the 600 people like him will have an advocate making sure that they get their justice.
Senator Martinez, will you be producing, if elected, your own reports or at the discretion of the chief judge?
Absolutely. I think that's been the problem at the clerk's office. Like I said, it's been a dark cloud. I think that will actually, every information that comes out of that office should be made public. Data, especially data. And data is going to be instrumental in really looking at what's going on at the clerk's office. The information that we are able to obtain will help open it up and actually bring that transparency that this office has so much lacked. So I really believe that working with attorneys, working with the different entities that are out there, you know, they are these folks are the ones that really know what is going on within and what they need in order to get the information to be able to get those missing records or missing information that's needed on these to get someone out of jail. But the fact that we have to work collaboratively together to really redefine, restructure, reform this office that has lacked that transparency. So yes, data and everything that's collected, information that's collected through FOIA, it has to be put out there so people can really feel, get that public confidence back that has long been lacking in this office. So I really feel good about the fact that for the first time we're going to be able to have that and that we're going to be able to gather partners that will help us reform that office, that data information will be useful in looking at the budget and looking at the aspect of that of the $124 million budget that we have there and where those dollars are actually being spent. The data is important for us to be able to get to that place that we can do reforms, real true reforms. One of the things that I wanted to also add when you talk about technology, right now you can pay fines online, but you can't pay court costs. People have to take time off work. That's another component that needs to be added to the technology for people to make it very easy for people to be able to go online and take care of their business as opposed to taking time off work, losing pay, or whatever the case may be, and moving the clerk office forward with the data that's going to be necessary out there for us to transform that office.
Thank you, Senator. Mr. Meister, do you plan, if elected, to produce your own data reports from the office or at the discretion of the chief judge?
Absolutely. I think it's one of the essential functions, and it's really, I think there's two main areas where our current clerk has almost hidden information. The clerk's office accounting functions, and this is very not really well understood by most people, the clerk handles hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars a year and has a back office accounting function that has almost no accountability. There was an audit done I think it was 5 years ago, 4 years ago, that found huge gaps in accounting. There's about $20 million over a period of time that can't really be accounted for. We need to have regular audits. It needs to be transparent. One of the problems is that we've got accounting systems that are still, in certain cases, manually reconciled on ledger paper in pencil. So we don't have a single accounting system, a general ledger system, and that needs to change. I will have regular audits so that there is sunlight and transparency on the financial operations of the office. And the other thing is in hiring and firing. The office is currently under a Shackman decree. You know, one of the newspapers recently said that their great fear is that the 1,400 employees, the party machine, just wants to get control and keep control of that office. It is historically a bastion of patronage that the party machine has had control of. Richard J. Daley's driver used to be the manager of the clerk's office patronage system. No experience in the courts, but lots of experience in making sure that precinct captains and others had jobs. That's what this office has been used for. I will absolutely comply with all the Shackman decree. I applaud this office for becoming transparent and having hiring practices, promotion from within, and making sure we have the best workforce out there that's qualified for the job, not politically accountable.
Thank you. Senator Boykin, I'm sorry, Commissioner Boykin.
You can promote me. It's okay. I'll take that promotion, as long as it's the United States.
I don't know, there's a lot of recordings
about
that.
I don't want to go to Springfield.
You might not want to go.
No, let me say this, that when I was a county commissioner, I did weekly reports to my district. Every week, people got a report from me on what it was that we were doing on their behalf. When I'm clerk of the circuit court, I'll do quarterly reports to the people of Cook County, letting them know how many lawsuits, how many cases we've dealt with, letting them know what it is that we're doing on their behalf. I think it's vitally important that we do those reports, but I also think it's vitally important that we work with the chief judge to sort of move him along too. One of the things that I hope to do is have such a relationship with the chief judge that I can take him and do an initiative in the public schools and actually take a judge and take a clerk into the public schools and talk about the role of the clerk and the chief judge in our court system. And I think that's important because young people need to understand the role of our justice system before they become a part of it, especially in the African American community. I believe that, you know, something was mentioned earlier about a gentleman who, you know, didn't get his file and that sort of thing. I think that's tragic. I think that should never happen. And when I'm clerk, we're gonna make sure that we do everything within our within our ability to make sure that everybody's fully trained and fully motivated to understand that the clerk's office has the ability to take away a person's freedom or to have a person win a case or lose a case. And so we don't want to have that happen. We certainly will have an office that's free of political influence. Anybody who knows me knows that I'm unbossed and unafraid. They know I'm a Democrat, but I'm not going to be controlled by the Democratic Party. Business as usual at the clerk's office is unacceptable and will not be tolerated under Boykin's administration. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. I want to remind everybody that this is your opportunity to fill out the cards that are on the table to ask the questions of the candidates for clerk. I can't help but say it's something that almost every attorney practicing in Cook County has wanted to ask questions as to the clerk as to how the office operates and why. Mr. Meister, you raised the issue of patronage, and that is one of our questions that is going to be for the whole group, for all of the candidates, but we'll start with you. What will you do, if elected, to deal with the issue of patronage, and how will you build morale and trust in the office?
It's one of my primary issues because I think anybody who's been practicing in the circuit court knows all too well that there are tremendous numbers of politically hired people working there who really hold their, whose real bosses are the political operatives in Cook County, and that's the history of this office. So we have hundreds of employees that are, the Speaker, Michael Madigan, is seeking to protect and will throw large sums of money into this race in order to protect it. That's the history of the office, and when you look at it going back decades, as far as the eye can see, the political interests have been trying to protect that. I'm personally disgusted. I went through the Cook County Democratic Party slating process. I'm a lifelong Democrat. I hold out great hope that my party will do better. But during that process, I had many committeemen who came over to me and said, I'll support you, but I need two jobs and four promotions. And that is...
Who are these people, Jacob? What are their names?
That is,
who are they?
That is the sad reality of this office. And I don't think that comes as a surprise to anyone. And we're in an environment right now where we're seeing people being called out for practices that have been happening for far too long, and the voters won't take it anymore. We're, you know, whether it's the ComEd, whether it's Ed Burke, whether it's you know, Arroyo, we've seen our patients pushed to the end, and our court system right now cannot handle any more patronage and this whole history of coveting those jobs for political purposes. So I will work with the Shackman Monitor and make sure that we have absolute best practices. We're going to promote from within, no longer bringing managers in who have no experience and making a morale problem, creating a horrible morale problem in the office.
Thank you, Mr. Meister. Senator Martinez.
First and foremost, when you talk about patronage and what's going on at the clerk's office, that's been, you know, one of the biggest problems that we've had there. You know, federal investigation going on. One of the things that I've said from day one is that when you look at the workforce that's there, the union employees, the Shackman employees, these are people that you cannot touch and we would never touch because those are really the backbone of that office. But when you look at all the people there that are at will, my first job is you're gonna have to reapply for that job. You're gonna have to tell me why you should stay on this job. And what if you contribute to the office? When you talk about these at will employees, especially the upper management, the ones that make the decisions and pass it on down to the workers, who are these individuals? Where did they get their job? Where did they get their job from? Who actually gave them the job? And how did they get the job? There's been talk out there about these people that pay for these jobs. Again, I would want a workforce at will who are going to explain to me who they are and what they have brought to that office. When you look at the mismanagement that's taken place for so long, I have to question those individuals. We want to bring in people that are going to bring something to the table, people that are going to bring expertise so we can turn that office around. Right now, those at-will employees are going to have to reapply or at least be re-interviewed as to why we should keep them and what are their plans. And maybe there's been no leadership in that office for so long, and that is a problem. But right now, the real key people there are the workforce that currently is there, and they are the ones that can help us redefine that office and really bring real transparency, and we can stop the patronage hiring that's been done all these past years in that office. So I really believe that the people at will are the ones that should be the ones answering the question and why they should stay there after all the mismanagement that has taken place for so long.
Thank you, Senator Martinez. Commissioner Kevin Argy, what will you do to address the patronage and morale issues in the clerk's office if elected?
So I'm the only one up here who has a track record having been in this situation. Chief Judge Tim Evans appointed me to fill a vacancy at the Board of Review when I was a federal prosecutor at the SEC. I was investigating fraud and corruption. I was breaking up pay-to-play schemes. And I think that's one of the reasons Chief Judge Evans appointed me to the Board of Review. I would bring that same commitment over to the clerk's office. At the Board of Review, I wrote the board's first ethics policy. I appointed the first ethics officer for the Board of Review. As I mentioned before, we need to start with a third party, and it's not an audit, just so we're clear. The clerk's office is audited every year as part of its annual budget process. We're talking about a third party external forensic investigation, not just checking the books and records, but taking a look at the operations for efficiency. There's a lot of talent in the office. We want to recognize and reward the talent. We want to retrain others, and then we want to replace other folks. Okay? But it's a huge ship. There's 1,400 employees. 1,200 of them are covered by a collective bargaining agreement with the Teamsters. There's a hiring monitor in place right now. And I just want to add, as a former SEC prosecutor, I would appoint monitors from time to time for a company. You would never have an open-ended monitor like you have at the clerk's office. You appoint a monitor for 24 months, 36 months, and they report back to you. But to have an open-ended monitor like we have right now is the exception. So on day one, I'd bring the monitor in and say, we have to figure out a plan for you to get out of the office. And I'd work with my labor team to motivate them and manage them right now. You have to take a look at who up here has already done this job. I think it's one of the reasons that the Sun-Times recognized I'm the right person when it endorsed me, and it said, Cook County voters have the best chance in two decades to put somebody in the job who will bring the office into the 21st century. It's a massive undertaking, one that we believe lawyer Michael Kevin Archie is best qualified to handle. I'm proud to have their endorsement along with the working families, the Chicago Federation of Labor, Personal PAC, Senator Durbin, Congresswoman Jan Schakowsky, and a number of other faith, labor, and political leaders throughout the city.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Boykin.
Would you please restate the question? Don't start my time yet.
No. We won't start your time. First. The question is, if elected, how will you address the issues of patronage in the office, as well as addressing morale and the public service component of the office?
Well, on day one, what I'm going to do is sit down with the leadership team and share my vision about reforming the office and making sure that we have a fully trained workforce. We're going to invest in training, customer service training in particular, and technology training, making sure that people understand the technology that they're using. We're going to do that on day one. We'll also set a level of integrity that basically says that we're going to drive a stake in the heart of patronage. We will not tolerate it. I didn't tolerate it when I was at the county board, and I won't tolerate it as the clerk of the circuit court. Now, you know, I've heard a lot up here, you know, folks talking about they're going to clean this up and they've done this. Why don't they start cleaning up Springfield? Why don't they start cleaning up the Board of Review, which has been seen as the darling of pay to play, where lawyers come in before the commissioners, get their clients' property taxes lowered, and then they turn around and make political contributions to those very commissioners. That is what is wrong with Illinois, and that we need to clean up. I won't take the rest of my time. I'll yield back the minute that I have left. Thank you.
I'll take that, Rich. I'll take that, Richard. Absolutely. I couldn't be more proud of my record as a former federal prosecutor who has cleaned up the Board of Review. Before I got there, it looked like the place Richard described. It no longer looks like that. I couldn't be more proud of our staff at the Board of Review. When I came to the Board of Review, we had 139 employees and we heard 125,000 appeals. This year we have 141 employees and we heard 252,000 appeals. So any of you who have managed an organization, how do you do double the work with the same staff? You bring in excellent people and you give them the technology and the tools they need to succeed. If anybody has any evidence of misconduct, please bring it to me and the federal prosecutors. If you don't, please don't disparage the good people at the Board of Review. They work too hard. They worked on President's Day. They'll be working this weekend as well.
I think we're done with this question. Although you're always free to bring up other issues. We have several questions, and we appreciate it. But if there's more, we're welcome to take them as well. Several of the attendees today have raised the question of a similar theme, and that is, why is this an elected office? What is the public policy that this office is involved in? Or why is this not just an administrative function? And we'll start with Senator Martinez.
Like I've said previously, the office should be independent from the from the Chief Justice office, in the sense, I think we can work together, I'm sorry, we can consolidate, we can find ways to save taxpayers' dollars and towards the future. Right now, we have an opportunity, because I know everybody says, why should it be elected and not appointed? I really believe right now, for the first time in 20 years, we have the ability to finally transform that office. And I think that should be something that we should be looking forward to. With the help of everyone that accessed that office, I think we can get our first, for the first time in 20 years, a state-of-the-art clerk's office. One of the things that I want to do is visit other counties and other states and look at their best practices, especially the large ones, and bring some of that back here to Illinois. That's the only way we're going to be able to continue to transform this office. And down the road, I think if that becomes a possibility, you know, I'm open to it. I would be open to it because I think that the more we reduce, you know, the way if we can actually bring together more entities, it will save taxpayer dollars. I think when you consolidate, you're able to do that. Right now, that office has not had a true leader in over 20 years. It's time now for us to, working together with everyone, transform that office and see if down the road that office should be an appointed office as opposed to an elected office. I am about consolidation. I am about saving the taxpayer money. I'm about trimming the fat that exists right now in that office and making it into a very efficient but very hardworking office. The people there deserve better. The workers that are there deserve to be heard and retrained and be given opportunities. I really believe that that's what I would do with that office.
Thank you, Senator Martinez. Mr. Meister.
Yeah, this is, I believe this should be an appointed office, frankly. The Illinois Constitution provides that the clerk of the circuit court shall either be public elected or appointed by the judges of the circuit court. There's about 300 elected voting judges who do everything from appointing associate judges to electing their own chief judge, and it is a democratic process among the judges. Now, that's not 100% without politics, but it greatly reduces the amount of politics. Let's face it, this office performs ministerial functions. There is not a great deal of policy making that goes on, and the office needs to operate efficiently. What we've seen over the last decades is a series of clerks who have to go out and raise substantial sums of money in order to get elected, and they are beholden to the political machine to get that done. This is not the state's attorney's race that's awash in cash. This is where we have to have a clerk who goes and sells jobs for $15,000 each across the street from the courthouse at the corner bakery. That's what it's come down to. One of my opponents has taken 128 violations, ethics violations. It's been cited for 128 over the limit contributions from the very property tax appeal lawyers and litigants who appear before him, and that's what he's using to fund this election. He's not only cited for it in 2017 and 2018, but has continued on even after being cited, taking over the limit ethics violations. This office needs to be pulled out of the political arena, and it's ministerial. Let the judges appoint a clerk for a term of 4 or 6 years so that this office gets out of the Stone Age, out of the political morass, and is finally able to function and do its job.
Commissioner Cavanaugh gets 30 seconds to respond as well as answer the question as to why this is an elected and what office rather than a appointed.
That's a lot of math.
Mark is a great timer.
I was going to say, he's got a lot of cards there, too. To answer the first question, should it be elected or appointed? I believe in more democracy, not less. I believe it should be elected. I believe, though, that the voters need more information, which means more transparency, which means all of you are to be given a lot of credit for doing this forum. And for those folks who are covering this race and covering the office, thank you. I know it feels like for the Civic Federation, for 20 years, you've been writing reports to deaf ears. I've read them and I've heard them. I believe in more democracy, not less. I support an elected school board. I think when you give the voters the information they need, the opportunity to vote, they participate in the process. As to other allegations, Jacob has been throwing these allegations since last summer. They're unfounded. He's been engaging in these old school political tactics. The week I filed my petitions, he went in and he did the oldest school thing in the world, filed a petition challenge.
We spent a lot of time and a lot of money, and the hearing officer threw out the challenge, and then it went to the Board of Elections, and they unanimously threw out his challenge. So what did he do that week? He had lunch with a friend who had a press conference admitted. She had lunch with him and wanted to help him out, so they came up with some complaint that they filed with the Board of Ethics. It's been weeks now. I've not heard anything from the Board of Ethics. I've not heard anything from the Board of Elections. Again, he's engaging in these things because he desperately wants to run again, a failed campaign, against Dorothy Brown. I'm not Dorothy Brown. I'm a former federal prosecutor who's brought ethics and reform in the one county office, and I'll do the same thing with the next office. I'm the one who's led and managed an office. Again, when you read the Sun Times editorial, they point that out. I'm ready on day one to do the job. Thank you.
Commissioner Boykin. Unless Mr. Meister wanted to take a step.
I would like to, because we have published online the citation issued by the Board of Ethics against Mr. Cabanarchi for taking 128 separate violations of the ethics ordinance by exceeding the caps that are placed on the amount that those who appear before him, the attorneys, the appellants that appear before him in the Board of Review are allowed to contribute. There are caps. 128 times he was cited through the end of 2017. Those violations, it's right in the public record. It's right on his D2s filed with the Board of Elections. Those violations have continued all the way through the end of last year. It's important, the Sun Times noted that their great reservation with respect to Cabanarchi is that he has strong ties to the old school Democratic organization. Quote, he is vice chair of the Democratic Party.
Out of time.
And we're pretty sure the party bosses want him to control those 1,400 jobs.
Thanks, Lawrence.
I'll try and do this again. So what Jacob's referring to is that since I've been at the Board of Review, we've had three different campaign finance laws. In 2015, my colleagues and I got a letter from the Board of Ethics explaining that the campaign finance laws for the county had been changed and we were over the limits. So, did I challenge the law? Did I go to the circuit court? Did I go to the appellate court? Did I go to the Supreme Court like Joe Berrios? No. I wrote a refund check for all of the complaints and for all of the refunds, and I've heard nothing more from the Board of Ethics since then. As you heard from the beginning, I spent my whole career in public service. I can't self-fund a race, unlike Jacob Meister. Last time Jacob ran, he wrote himself checks for about $400,000. I don't have that opportunity, so I have to fundraise. But when I fundraise, I always fundraise within the law, and I'll continue to do so.
Since your name was raised, Mr. Meister, you get 30 seconds final response.
I think the public record speaks for itself. He's just indicated he had violations. He was caught. It was 128 violations. Those violations have continued all the way through his most recent reporting in December of 2019. The public record speaks for itself.
Thank you. Commissioner Boykin.
Why can't we all just get along?
That's what I've been saying.
Don't start my time yet. Restate the question, man. All this back and forth, I don't even remember the question.
Fair enough. Thank you. The basic question is, the clerk's office does not appear to have really policy-making role, does not, and why is this office elected? And I guess you could add to that whether you would support making it an appointed rather than an elected office.
I like my friend Jacob Meister, but I think it's a bad idea to have it be appointed. And I'll tell you why. One, the office ought to be accountable to the people. And I think that's vitally important. When you think about Operation Greylord, where you had 93, I think, judges who got prosecuted for bribes, and you had clerks who were also caught up in that same system of bribes and fixing cases and that sort of thing. And so I think it's important to keep that office independent. Let me also say this, that it's a vitally important office. The clerk is a part of what we call the judicial stakeholders group that was set up by the Illinois Supreme Court. And that means there is an opportunity for policy making. I talked about automatic expungement earlier. Clerk Dorothy Brown, to her credit, and I know people up here will criticize her, until the final debate. But let me say this, she's known as the leader on expungement. That is important. People from all across the country come to Cook County to see how we do our expungements. Now, she does an annual expungement summit that has over 1,000 people there seeking to get their records cleared so that they can work and become meaningful, productive citizens. I'll do quarterly expungements. I'll do 4 every year to make it smaller and more intimate and get people help. But I think it's an opportunity for policymaking in this office, not just automatic expungement, but reforming fines and fees. I also think there's some other things that we can do from the policy side of things to help people in their real everyday lives. And so I think it's important for us to keep this office as an elected office, and I'm proud to yield back 20 seconds.
Thank you, Commissioner Boykin. One of our audience questions, discussion regarding, many of you have raised in the discussion, the idea of elimination of fees and fines as a benefit to the public users. However, the funds operations of these fees fund the operations of the office. How will you pay for the proposed initiatives such as technology upgrades and elimination of paper if we eliminate the fees? All of these improvements that are needed are expensive. So we'll start with Mr. Meister. Where are you on fees? And if you eliminate fees, how will you fund the office or improvements to the office?
Well, the circuit court actually generates far more in fees than it spends. It is a net moneymaker for Cook County. I do believe that we have way too many fees in place. And some of that will be taken care of by use of technology. I think we can make the office much more efficient and ultimately achieve cost savings. I do believe that defendants, for instance, we've got, it's the most expensive state in the country for defendants to actually appear and defend themselves. There's a certain absurdity when you are sued to be dragged into court and required to pay a check, pay a fee just for the privilege of defending yourself. And if you're facing a eviction or something else, or, you know, eviction or foreclosure or another life tragedy, to have to write a check just to appear in court and defend yourself, I think is fundamental unfairness. So I think our fee system has to be examined. There was just a huge bill that went through in Springfield that adjusted fees across the board. It is sunsetting at the end of this year, and I think we need to re-examine that and ease the burden on litigants. But I think we can also achieve efficiencies, tremendous efficiencies. For instance, I've suggested, or I want to have electronic ticketing. We've got 135 police forces across Cook County. Right now, they all handwrite out tickets to the tune of $950,000 a year. Those should be automated so that they can swipe a driver's license. It goes right, auto-populates, goes right into our court system. It eliminates a tremendous amount of costs. Those are the types of efficiencies we need to create. It also cuts down police time tremendously, and it saves a tremendous amount in overtime from police officers showing up in court only to find out that the case has been disposed of or continued. I think we can have efficiencies and lower court costs.
Thank you, Mr. Meister. Senator Martinez.
Again, the fees and fines, again, we have to look at the structure, the fee structure, and see how we can find ways to maybe to reduce it. Eliminating them is a little bit hard, given that we don't know yet. I think after some of these audits and these FOIA information comes out and the data comes out of the clerk's office, now that we have an opportunity to open it up, I think we need to look at the fee structure. I think down in Springfield, we are talking about something that's in conversation right now of the sunsetting of that act. So we have to look at that. But I really believe that we have to be much more conscious of these individuals that are paying these fees, you know, and look at their economic, you know, situation. They want to get back to work. If they're, you know, or they want to be able to provide for their families, but sometimes these fees really weigh them down. We have to help our especially the black and brown communities, where you see them, you know, where you see the biggest issue. We have to find ways to help them be able to lift themselves up as opposed to continue to get more and more indebted. We have to be much more conscious of that in the clerk's office. We have to be able to look at this fee structure and see how we can restructure it so it is fair, that it's fair, and then also look at what these dollars are being used for within the clerk's office. Are they being useful efficiently in the right areas? Are we providing the technology that's really necessary for us to be able to bring these fees down? Because I think technology is a big answer in that question. Is it the answer for the entire clerk situations going on? Absolutely not. But it's a start in the right direction as far as addressing the issue within that office and how these fees, the dollars are being used, these fees, how the dollars are being used within the budget, but how we can find efficiency in utilizing those dollars, asking less from the individuals and making much more efficiency within the office with the technology.
Thank you, Senator Martinez. Commissioner Kevin Argy.
The current fiscal year budget for the office is approximately $124 million. $21 million that comes from the four special purpose fund fees. As I mentioned before, we have to take a look at those special purpose fund fees, see the services they're supposed to deliver, and determine if we can put them on a path to sunset once they've delivered those purposes. If they're not tied to delivering a service and they don't have an end date, then they just become general operating revenue fees and they should be reflected in that as such. If they're tied to a service when the service is ended, then we should eliminate the fee. As we've talked before about the transparency issue, the Illinois Supreme Court implemented a new statewide fee structure effective July 2019, which is intended to standardize fees across the state for civil, criminal, and traffic court cases. More information is required from the clerk's office to determine if the clerk of court's office is complying with this fairly and openly. There needs to be more reporting, as we talked about. It's more than just the annual fiscal process. It's regular annual reports, regular budgeting, more information as well. We cannot fund the operations of government on the backs of those who can least afford to pay it. The example I want to get is one I was bringing up before, but I was cut short on time, is ending cash bail, because this is so vitally important. Right now, the clerk of the court is allowed to hold from $5 to $100 of any cash bail before it's returned to the litigant. So understand, they've been arrested, they've gone through the criminal justice system, they've been found not guilty, they leave with their cash bail. The clerk holds $100 back. Last year, the clerk of court held back $4.8 million from folks who went through the criminal justice system and determined found not guilty, but kept $100 for processing. We have to look at for a way to take that $4.8 million and put it back in those people's pockets because they've been found not guilty and yet they paid a price for it.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Boykin.
The court system has been viewed as a part of that institutionalized racism that continues to perpetuate serious harm to mainly African Americans, Latinos, and other poor people. On day one, I will actually forgive those fees that people have accumulated as a result of tickets and that sort of thing. I can't tell you how many people I talked to once I unveiled my plan on fees and fines about a month and a half ago. People came up to me and said, you know, I had to file bankruptcy because I got some red light camera tickets and the fees doubled on them and I got some additional fines and I just couldn't afford to pay them. And I mean, this wasn't a lot of money. This was like $1,000. And so it may not be a lot to us up here, but for the average citizen, they have difficulty coming up with like $400 in emergency funds. And so we must do something about this. It's the right thing to do. The time is now. And I tell you, we will do something about it. I think that fees and fines ought to be based on a sliding scale on a person's ability to pay. We shouldn't continue to penalize people because they just don't have the resources. The reason why this automatic expungement is so important, we were suspending people's licenses because they didn't pay their fees and fines. If a person drives a truck for a living or they drive Uber for a living and they have child support payments that are due, you suspend their license, you effectively bankrupt them because they still have to make those child support payments. How are they going to do it? They can't do it. because you've taken their ability to work away. And so I'm glad that the governor passed that bill. Now we got to take it a step further and help people clear up their credit and help restore their lives and restore hope in our communities. Thanks.
Thank you, Commissioner Boykin. This will be our final question. It comes from our friend Alexandra Block from the Chicago Council of Lawyers and the Chicago Appleseed Fund. The clerk's office is statutorily permitted to retain private debt collectors to collect fines, fees, and costs from criminal defendants at an increase of over 15% interest that is due to the collections agency. This is a huge additional debt burden for many people. Will you commit to ending collection agency contracts with the clerk's office? We'll start with you, Commissioner Boykin.
Oh, you just heard it. You know where I stand on this. I think it's a bad deal for the taxpayers of Cook County. I especially think it's a bad deal for black folks, people who look like me and Latinos, who can ill afford to pay these debt collection fees. I will, on day one, reverse those fees. I'll forgive those fees. Clerk Brown does it through what we call Amnesty Week, where she works with the debt collection agencies to get them to forgive it. Look, I have to see how long that contract goes, but we won't be renewing that contract. I don't think it's in the best interest of the county taxpayer to actually do that. And I know some people might say, well, how are we going to fund the court system? The question is that we should not be looking to assess fees and fines to fund the court system. We fund it the way we ought to fund it, through taxpayer dollars from Springfield and through the county board. That's how we fund our court system. We don't fund it on people who can't afford to pay. That's not the right way to go. And so I'll do everything I can within my power to actually end this process of harming communities wholesale and harming people, individual groups of people. It's not right to drive people into bankruptcy. It's not right to ruin people's credit. And it's not right to foreclose their opportunity to jobs, to educational loans, and to public housing. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Cabanargi.
Sure. And you just heard me talk about it before, the issue of private debt collection, which I'm glad you brought up. It starts before that. It starts determining, do we need to collect the fees and implement the fines? Do a rigorous search to see are they collected to the service we're providing. But then on the back end, yes, I completely agree to not extend any private debt collection contracts the clerk of the court's office has. Again, thanks to the Appleseed Fund for Justice for a second. The four of us appeared at our first panel together at an Appleseed Fund for Justice Chicago Council of Lawyers panel. And thank them and the Civic Federation again for having us together to talk about these issues that are important. So I would end private debt collection. As you see in my reform plan, it's ending the unnecessary fees and fines goes back to this idea of funding the operations of court on the back of the people who can least afford to pay it. Another issue as well in there is, and we talked about expungement a little bit, is I want to be the partner along with Kwame Rule and Kim Fox in cannabis expungement. Right now it's the law of the land where there's over 770,000 people in Illinois who have an eligible conviction related to a cannabis offense. Those records are expunged. The conviction is expunged, though, not the underlying record necessarily. So again, everybody does their job and that record comes off the books. But what about the underlying records related to it? And I look at this through the lens of a federal prosecutor. There's an arrest record. There's a booking photo. There's a fingerprint card. There's a suburban police officer's notes in a file. Those are the responsibility of the clerk's office. So while if you go into the system and it shows that there was no offense and there's no conviction, that underlying paperwork is out there. And we all know in an era of e-everything, it's out there. And if a young person doesn't get a scholarship, somebody doesn't get a job, somebody doesn't get a lease, and they're wondering why, it's because the clerk of the court's office didn't do their job and take all of that paper and expunge it. Not just the offense, but all the documents that relate to it.
Thank you, Commissioner. Senator Martinez.
Thank you. I too will end that, extend the contract. I will eliminate the contract for the private debt collection. I think I agreed with many of my colleagues up here that we have to help common folks out there. We have too many people that have had to file bankruptcy, have had to file all kinds of financial woes because of the fact that they have these collections coming after them for their debt. We really need to help our people in the judicial system. Again, it's a black, we have a lot of, many, many black and brown folks that are right now sitting in jail or right now are in this debt collection category, and we have to find ways in helping them, relieve them. We have an opportunity now for the first time, and I think this is what I'm excited about, is the fact that we really have an office that we can actually take back and reform and make it one of the best serving institutions for the county, for Cook County. We have to look at the best practices all over our country right now to address this issue. The private debt collection is something that has held many, many families down, many communities down, and our opportunity now to actually reform that office and bring that openness and transparency that it needs to really dig in and look at what we need to do to make this a better and a much more fair system. Our justice system is a system that right now we need to continue to reform. We've put things in place in Springfield to make sure that we can start that process. We have to continue to work with Springfield and with our, you know, with our county to find ways to relieve our communities of some of these situations that have held communities and people down. So I too, I join the other, my other colleagues here in saying that we have to end this practice and we have to find a better way of collecting fees in a way that is with integrity and that it actually will work for the people that it is serving. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. Mr. Meister.
Yep. You know, private debt collection, I believe, is a symptom of a bigger problem, which I alluded to earlier, which is that we have over-reliance in our system on fines, fees, and forfeitures. That is a much more fundamental problem that, you know, it's at the end of the line where you have these fines, fees, and forfeitures being imposed, and you have to, it's clerk's job to collect them. That's what the law says. We need to go more fundamentally and re-examine our whole system of fines, fees, and forfeitures. I completely agree with a lot of what's said here. Suspension of driver's licenses, suspension of professional licenses, is a device that we've used to try to collect unjust fines, fees, and forfeitures. We need to work very closely with the folks in Springfield. This legislation that's sunsetting, we can put a lot of good things into there. If somebody has a fine, fee, or forfeiture they can't afford to pay, let's credit them for community service so that they have a way. And that's something that the Appleseed has worked on. It's in legislation, prior legislation. Unfortunately, the defendants only get $4 an hour credit for the time that they've worked. We have to up that to a realistic amount, keeping in mind that we have minimum wage. Will I stop the worst of the collection practices? You bet I will. But more fundamentally, we have to stop our system, our regressive system of fines, fees, and forfeitures. There was a Supreme Court forum a week ago where it was asked whether this 10% bond practice, keeping 10% of the bond, would be stopped. And the Supreme Court justice and the candidate said, well, all these downstate counties can't afford to operate unless they get that money. And that's unjust, especially if somebody's acquitted, to take that money even though they're innocent. That's wrong, and that's a wrong way to be funding our courts.
Thank you, Mr. Meister. How about a round of applause for all of our panelists? Thank you to all of you for joining us today. This has been a very informative and topical discussion. The Civic Federation did invite the Republican candidate for the clerk's office, but she was unable to attend this event. And we are affording the opportunity in the general election for her to speak before us as well. I would be remiss if I did not mention the great work that Annie McGowan and Isabella Romano provided, the staff of the Civic Federation. They were instrumental in getting this event pulled together. I'd also like to express our appreciation to Donovan Pepper and Carol Thompson, who chair our justice. And thank you for all of your guidance. Thank you all for being here. Thank you for supporting the Civic Federation. Now our friend David Cohn, thank you for hosting us, and he's gonna come up with some final words. Thank you.
Well, Lawrence, thank you, and thank you, ladies and gentlemen, and to the candidates here today. It is one of the hallmarks of democracy that we hear from those seeking to represent us in public office. And today's program has been consistent with that tradition. I know we've all come away from today's event understanding more about the positions of these candidates and their qualifications for the office that they seek. And we thank you for taking time out of your busy day to join us and the Civic Federation for this important forum. So thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Again, our thanks to Lawrence Massal, the Civic Federation, and its wonderful team. Ladies and gentlemen, we hope you have a wonderful weekend. We are adjourned. Thank you.